everybody. So happy to be back here today. Welcome, welcome to Fearlessly Facing 50, the live stream. I am over the moon excited to have with me a very special, special guest. If you listen to the podcast, the incredible Joan Lunden was on with me. She'll probably correct me. I want to say about 6 months ago, before we went into the whole lockdown and all of the craziness. So I'm so thrilled to have her here. I wanted just to tell you that Joan wrote a fantastic book, Why Did I Come Into This Room, which we talked about on the podcast, A Candid Conversation About Aging. It's a book you just have to pick up. It's a great holiday gift. It's just amazing. And she really is just a natural about talking about aging with grace and just really putting it out there. You're going to laugh. You're going to cry. It's just, it's a fantastic read. So today I have with me award-winning journalist, nationally best-selling author, healthcare advocate, and a true just pinch me moment for me. Joan, welcome. I'm so happy you're here.
It's always good to talk to you, Amy.
Oh, thank you. And look at your bright periwinkle blue. I love it. I will show this.
We're matchy. Great minds think alike, Amy.
Great minds think alike. We both have the glasses and oh my goodness. So how are you, Joan?
I'm terrific. Thank you.
Yeah, good. You made it through the summer. I know you were, you know, you didn't have your typical summer. I think you kind of were transported out east a little ways up north, northeast. And I bet you enjoyed it.
Well, yeah, because my husband owns summer camps for children. That's what he does. And he owns a couple of big summer camps up in the state of Maine. Just about 27 miles outside of Portland is a beautiful lake called Long Lake.
Oh, it sounds beautiful.
And that's where the boys' camp is, Camp Tuckahoe. And then about 15 minutes away, there's a trip lake camp. That's the girls' camp. However, they didn't open. Wow. You know, we just weren't in a place where you could confidently do that in a safe way. Yeah. So it, you know, my husband has been at that camp every summer since he was like, I think 7 years old, and he's now 59 years old, just turning 60 in a couple of months. And it was so strange, but we all went up there and his demise was our playground.
Exactly.
We kept a few counselors around, mainly boat drivers.
Yeah.
So the kids could water ski and banana boat and all that. We kept the chef for the summer so that we could stay alive.
Yes.
So we had the most magnificent summer. That to me is always my time of the year where I'm the most physical and outgoing and in good condition. I always say I always have to make sure that my annual physical checkup is in September because I come back my best self.
Do you?
Oh,
do you think that is because you're outside and you're in nature and you're just
because I'm outside and you can go out and walk, we hike, and because I have a trainer up there that I love.
Yeah.
And I put together a workout group. My husband once said to me, I'm never going to ask you to do anything at camp. Like, what am I going to do? Ask Joan Lunden to teach art?
I mean, exactly.
But there's one thing I want you to do.
Yeah.
I want you to meet this wonderful trainer that I've known for years, and I want her to come here, and I want you to get all of the wives of my male important personnel to get together with you, and then I want you to like do a really kick butt session so that at 9:30 at night when they're like, where's my husband? He should be here with me. And they're, of course, off settling a dispute amongst a bunch of 10-year-olds.
Right.
That I want them to be asleep in bed, tired. And, you know, I did it. And I got to tell you, it was the best thing for me. Because if I had just had this fitness trainer coming once a day, because I did it 5 days a week.
Right.
I might have, you know, I don't know. I might have not done it all the time.
Right,
and instead, I had this group of women. We had the music going.
Love it.
It let me meet all the other, you know, become much more of a part of camp. And all my plans were made around that fitness class every day because I never wanted to.
You didn't want to miss it.
Yeah.
You didn't want to miss it.
And I think that's important for other women too. I always find that women who get together with other women, sometimes it's the parents of your kids' friends in school.
Yeah.
Seems to me that when your kids are in grammar school up through middle school and high school, those are your best friends.
Yes.
But, you know, and meet and like go to the school pickup line half an hour early and get out and walk the football field.
Yes.
Or, you know, to me, whenever I've worked out with a good friend, I feel that they're not only our cheerleaders, but they're there to guilt us.
True.
Guilt us into going.
Exactly. Where
we might have like slid back and said, maybe not today.
Right.
So it's always good to have a buddy.
So let's talk about that because, you know, friendships, I mean, it comes up a lot, you know, especially because I talk a lot about midlife and beyond. And when you're in your 50s and friends, it's challenging. And I think, you know, we have to kind of allow ourselves to give ourselves permission to say, okay, our friendships evolve and they change, but it's so important, right? As we get older, to have those friends in our lives.
And sometimes it's tough for women when all the kids go off to college.
Right.
And you don't have that connection anymore.
Yeah.
But it's really important. I think I called this the chapter on friendship in my book, Friends Are Therapists You Can Drink With.
That's spot on. Yeah.
But friends, you know, we might have talked about this the last time, Amy, that the three things that experts say will predict how well you will age, how successfully you will age are staying engaged in life.
Mm-hmm.
Social connections, friendships, not just that one, you know, child that's going to come over and take care of you. Friendships. The third one is a sense of purpose, you know, getting up, whether it's a garden you need to take care of, a painting that you're in the middle of, or, you know, some volunteering at the hospital, whatever it is, it's something to get up, get out of bed, get dressed, and have a place to go. And friendships, I mean, that's, you know, half the fun of doing anything is sharing it with your friends. And and when you're down, having somebody to call and have kind of that shoulder to cry on. And I mean, it just makes such a big difference in the life of everyone, but particularly as you grow older.
Yeah. And
if women are listening and they don't really have a good gaggle of gals, think about ways you can do it. It can be, sometimes it's at a gym or a workout class. Sometimes it's with a book club. You know, you can look for book clubs in your area. Right now it's all remote, but it might be through a church, through a synagogue, through a senior group in your area. There's something here where I live in Greenwich, Connecticut called At Home in Greenwich. And I only found out about it because they asked me to come and speak, which I did. But basically they're an organization for, I don't know, it's $75 a year or something. And you see this calendar all the time with all these activities going on, and they go to movies together and they do all these things, and they have volunteers that go and pick up seniors. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea is to not let you be isolated.
Yeah. Because
one thing I discovered in doing the research for the book, I think we all know that isolation isn't good for you, but when I learned that medical experts say that the impact, the negative impact on your body from isolation is equal to smoking 15 cigarettes a day.
I did hear something like that. That
was surprising to me. I mean, that's really, really bad.
Yeah. So how are you doing with this whole remote, you know, are you doing like cocktail parties online? Are you doing the Zoom thing? I mean,
I haven't done cocktail parties online, but gosh, I wish I would have known ahead and been able to invest in Zoom.
Isn't that the truth?
I know. Verb now. I we're Zooming.
We're Zooming.
But I, you know, I'm like a glass half full girl, admittedly, but maybe a week into the pandemic, I said, I'm going to stay connected. I started doing Facebooks every day at 1 o'clock, Monday through Friday.
Brilliant.
Which I did up until summertime when I went up to Maine. And then I said to everybody, hey, I got to walk my talk, and I don't believe in all work and no play. This is my summertime. But and my husband would come in and say, what are you doing? Like every time I look at you, you're on the phone. Sorry about that.
Yep.
You are either booking someone or you're interviewing someone. I mean, why are you doing this? You're not being paid for it. And I said, because I'm good at it and I like it and it's fun.
And
I'm not bored.
But you know, that's
about being bored. I'm not bored.
And I think it's funny because I think men do process that differently. My husband will say the same things. you know, well, what are you doing exactly? But I do think there's that, there's just that strength in connections and those conversations. And yeah, I loved your lives because, and you had such great engagement from people that were, you know, that were listening and found value in that. And it's so important, especially for those people that really did feel isolated at that point, you know?
And that's, you know, it's such an issue. I mean, right now, of course, it's this huge issue with just everyone.
Right.
But you can kind of give the same advice. I mean, get outside. You know, the one of the, it sounds so little and so, you know, simple that it couldn't be important, but it is. And especially if you get outside in the morning, because a lot of people are having trouble sleeping right now. I mean, anxiety. I could actually go into that more. If you don't manage your stress, when you are stressed out, you produce adrenaline.
Right.
You produce this one thing. I'm sorry, I don't remember the thing. It's
cortisol?
In the,
no, not cortisol.
And in order to produce that, adrenaline is produced.
Okay.
So if you don't manage your stress during the daytime, at about 3 o'clock in the morning, you find that you wake up. And everybody thinks that they're waking up because they have to go pee. Yeah. But actually, you're waking up because that's the time of the night that your thyroid can, everybody's, all your body parts are on like this circadian clock. That's the time for the thyroid to start working.
Right.
And it needs this certain thing, but you've used it all day long. There's nothing left. And in order to produce it, you know what gets produced? Adrenaline.
There you go.
And the adrenaline wakes you up. And then once you're awake, your bladder says, oh, you woke up? Okay, fine, let's go pee. But everybody thinks it's the other way around. So if you, you know, if you try to manage your stress, find things to do. I mean, when else in our entire life are we ever going to get the opportunity to clean out our sock drawer?
Yeah.
Roll them up. And to read all the books. Like, I got a gazillion books behind me. I've not read them all. But to read those, I'm a jigsaw puzzle addict.
Yeah.
I'm a jigsaw puzzle addict.
Yeah.
And I've probably done, I don't even know if I should admit to this, maybe 30 or more jigsaw puzzles since the world closed down. I did a ton of them here. I'm looking at them. It's like a 5 foot stack. Not to mention I did them up in Maine and I left that stack up there. So I'm going to find somewhere to donate them all to, like, maybe senior communities or something.
Fabulous.
But I love that. I don't really know how to meditate very well. I've never been.
I know. I've been having more and more shows about that. I'm similar in that it's hard for me to relax, but I think there's a lot of power in that.
Have other ways, like, to me, jigsaw puzzling is a meditation because when I'm into it and I'm looking, like, I've seen that piece before. I mean, I do these for my brain as much as anything.
Yeah.
I'm getting too good at them. That's the bad thing. And I'll say, I know, it's like concentration. What was under number 2 and what was under number 28? Remember that game?
Exactly. Yes.
So I'm so engrossed in it that I'm not thinking about my to-do list. Same with reading. To me, reading a book is meditation because when I'm reading a book, I am not part of this world.
Right.
I am part of the world and it transports you. And I'm there with these characters and I'm dying to know what's going to happen to them next, which is why I lose a lot of sleep at night. I can be up until 2 or 3 in the morning when I'm in the middle of a good book.
Look, you know, I agree. Yeah. And we do have to find that. We have to, like you always say too, treat yourself. I say treat yourself as a guest of honor. Make yourself a priority or at least make the list so that you do care about, you know, those self-care things we have to put, you know, into place, especially at this time when it is crazy, but use the time we have. Cause you know, when we do get back to regularly scheduled business, we're going to be back to our routines and this is going to be a distant memory and we should utilize the time. So puzzles, that's a good one. I'm leaving for a couple of weeks and I'm going to try to do that. I don't know if I'll do, how many did you do? 50?
I did at least
30
or so here, and I did some up in Maine too.
I love it.
You know, it's hard to take crossword puzzles with you when you go away.
Yeah.
You could do jigsaw puzzles. Yeah. But crossword puzzles,
oh yeah,
those you can get and you can take with you. And I've never really done those, but
they're challenging.
I'm really bad at it. I mean, maybe it's because you can't recall that word and you'll think, wait a minute, I know that word.
It's at the tip of my tongue.
I tried to start doing them like at the beginning of this pandemic because I figured it'd be a good brain teaser.
Yeah.
Couldn't believe how bad I was.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those things. Yeah, I'm a work in progress on those.
Yeah.
I want to ask you something because I recently had on, last month we talked a lot about breast cancer and you've been a survivor and just your whole story and your journey. Do you ever have those times, Joan, when you just lay in bed? I had a physician on and she said there's a lot of her patients will say there's that 2 a.m. time where they just wake up and their head is just spinning and they're so worried that it's going to come back. Do those things ever cross your mind? Do you worry about it coming back?
When I was going through treatment, of course, you're completely consumed. Mm-hmm. With the thought of cancer and that it's in your body and that it's there and growing and hopefully diminishing as you go through your treatment. During that time, I think I worried. In fact, I think I wrote in the book before, Why Did You Come Into This Room? I wrote, Had I Known. I think I said that I actually went in and cleaned out my underwear drawer and my sock drawer so that if I died, nobody would go and find out what unorganized person I was. But at the end of my treatment, I remember going in, my oncology nurses, those are the unsung heroes, the right. People who make us feel brave and strong when we are not feeling brave and strong. And they told me to be careful of my last day of treatment because everyone thinks they should come with balloons and make it a big hooray.
Yeah.
He said, and you might not feel that way because it's almost like somebody's opening the door and you're just like walking out into the unknown.
Yeah.
Because everyone's been checking on you every week, week in, week out, and making sure that everything's just right. And now all of a sudden it's like, walk out and have a nice life.
You ring the bell. Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember I used to be hearing from people on Facebook who would say, gee, now that you're coming to the end of your treatment, this is the problem with sharing everything with everyone. You're coming to the end of your treatment. How are you dealing with the fear of recurrence? Mm. I wanted to write them back and said, it never even occurred to me until you brought it up. But I did go into my oncologist that last day and say, in all honesty, how are we supposed to just like walk out of here? Right. And assume that it's gone and assume that we're okay. And he said to me, he took my hands in his hands and he said, you are going to follow the wise words of the great philosopher, Wile E. Coyote. He said, you remember that cartoon character? He would run off a cliff like at 100 miles an hour. Well, he was never in trouble until he looked down. He said, you keep your head up and know that you took the best treatment available and that you are going to walk through life with your head up and you are going to expect a good outcome. And he was so right. I mean, that is the way I walked out that door and that is the way I'm living my life. Of course, I remember my breast cancer surgeon. Well, I went from him over to her and she said, at 3 years, you're going to be cancer free because you had such an aggressive, fast growing cancer that after 3 years, if it was going to come back, it would have come back. But just remember, that doesn't mean you can't get another kind of breast cancer or another kind of cancer. It's like, whoa, Debbie Downer. Come on. Let me enjoy this just for a little while. But I think that attitude, of course, a positive attitude isn't going to cure your cancer. And sometimes people going through cancer get upset when I talk about a positive attitude. But being able to somehow dig down in and have a positive attitude, even when you're going through it, being a warrior, you can become a thriver, a survivor and a thriver. And I'm living my life now as a thriver. And that means that you've got to have this positive attitude. But it also means that you've got to make sure that you do all those things that can keep you from getting another cancer, which is eating as clean as possible, working out, going for all of your annual checkups, not just the mammogram, but understanding your breasts and understanding breast density. I didn't know anything about that, Amy. I knew nothing.
No.
And, you know, I was that person who they'd always call in for more pictures. Like, you freak out when that happens.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, why? Did you see something bad? And they just always said to me, no, it's just because you have such dense breasts, it's hard to see anything. I didn't know that was code for get an ultrasound.
Yeah.
And I mean, I learned that, I think I've told you that it was just by sheer luck that I was sent on a story to interview Dr. Susan Love about breast cancer, you know, renowned.
Unbelievable.
Breast book. And she was the one, you know, I told her how it was always so stressful going for mammograms because they were always calling me back for more pictures.
Right.
Because they said they couldn't see anything. And she said, whoa, 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 whoa.
Yeah.
You have dense breasts, then you must have an ultrasound every year, every, just like, you know, annually. If I hadn't gone on that interview,
yeah,
I wouldn't have known to ask for that ultrasound. I swear to God, I don't know if I'd be here talking to you right now.
Wow.
Because I had such a fast growing aggressive cancer.
Yeah. Yeah. You are such a warrior. You are. And you exude such positivity. I mean, when I was sitting with you in person, it's contagious when I'm around you. And I know for so many people, I applaud you for that. That's really a gift that you've been given, just that positive spirit and that energy. It's just contagious.
You know what? It is a gift. And I think I got it from both from my mom and my dad. My mom was just such a bubbly, effusive, positive thinker. It was like living with the Dalai Lama, you know?
I can relate to that.
It was my own little private positive guru.
Yeah. And
somebody once described her to me that she was like a shooting star. Mm. Even after she had left a room, you still felt that little twinkle of positive. Yeah. Activity, even after she had left. And I loved that description, but she certainly did her best to infuse that into me.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I infused it into my three older daughters because I see it.
You see it.
I'm trying with the teenagers, but when teenagers are actually teenagers.
Well, that's a work in progress. Yes, absolutely.
A work in progress, definitely.
Absolutely. So let's talk about, you know, a place for mom, which is in caregiving, which is so on your heart and been a part of your journey. And now, of course, with Second Opinion launching the TV show on PBS, which is going to be fabulous. I want to talk about that briefly.
Yeah.
Excited about that. But from a caregiving standpoint, you know, we're coming into the holidays now.
Yeah.
It's going to be a different holiday season for sure. Maybe large families aren't getting together, but yeah. Maybe it is a time that you're noticing things changing about your parents as they're aging.
Yeah.
What would be some
we can't go in with blinders on, Amy.
No.
And unfortunately, that's how a lot of us go in because we don't want to see how bad things are.
Yeah.
Be a snoop. See if the pile of mail is just not answered. And go in the refrigerator. Are the foods in the refrigerator fresh? Do they have healthy foods in the refrigerator? Medications
yes.
change the way they taste food.
Right.
Go in the bathroom. Are they being compliant with the medications they're supposed to take? I mean, if they're still okay for a while, stuff your purse full of night lights and put them in all the way down the hallway.
Yeah.
You know, take up any rugs, area rugs that they could slip on and fall. Like, think about that. And then when that time comes where, like with my mom, I knew she would have opened the door to anyone.
Right.
She scammed a few times on the phone. She would call the operator and ask her to give her a number for somebody that had already passed away. I mean, she just wasn't able to stay in her condo anymore on her own. It was
right.
obvious. And I had people coming in, and then people would be late. It was really hard. I mean, some people can work that out, and it's fabulous. But my mom's dementia just became exponentially worse. It was after my brother passed away. And so I needed to find somewhere where she could be, where there was special dementia care, because that's a rough.
Yeah.
Dementia and Alzheimer's is a real rough disease for caregivers to deal with and to understand and to know how. If you want any advice, I highly recommend you Google TIPA Snow, T and this would be a good guest for you to get, Amy. T-E-E-P-A, Teepa Snow is her name. And she's done a bunch of TED Talks on this. That's where I saw her first.
Yeah.
Because she helps us understand when we say something to someone who is just not kind of living in our reality completely. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they might be aggressive or seem angry about how to deal with them. And with my mom, because I did find somewhere for her to live where they understood how to deal with, and they helped me. Yeah. They said, don't walk in and start telling her how your high school kids are doing in soccer, because she's not attached to that world.
Right.
But come in and talk to her about when you were little and what life was like when you were growing up, and ask her questions about when she was a young woman. Those deeply embedded memories, those she can connect with.
Yeah.
But caregivers, this is National Caregivers Month that we're in right now.
Yeah.
And caregivers often overlook their own health. And statistically, they get chronic illnesses earlier than the rest of the population. And they overlook their own annual checkups more. And they tend to die before the other population that doesn't take care of a loved one. So you have to really understand and embrace that and take time for yourself. It's not being selfish.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of families out there that are also really struggling financially because they're dipping into their own retirement savings to take care of older parents.
Mm-hmm.
And the last thing we should say is that this is an unusual November, the most unusual November we'll ever live through.
Yeah.
So take it seriously and don't put older parents in danger.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are going to have people over, try to be outside if the weather is okay.
Right.
You're going to be inside. There's a whole bunch of CDC guidelines, and I know they seem a little off the charts.
I know. Yeah.
Bring your own dish. Bring your own silverware.
Open the windows.
Not completely wrong. You know, instead of having a rectangle table where people are like right across from each other, you know, have round tables, have them far apart. They've got some really good suggestions. We just came to the conclusion, admittedly, last night, we were going to have kind of a little bit more of an extended family here.
Right.
And we said last night, can't do it. Right. Jeff's sister's kids are in sports at school.
Yeah, exactly.
And like, so we can't have them come into the house. I have a son who has type 1 diabetes.
Right.
I can't put him at risk.
Right.
So we've all got to be, there'll be another Thanksgiving next year.
Exactly.
We really gotta be careful.
Be careful
right now, especially with every state's red, I think, right now.
I think so. It's everywhere. Yeah, it's back in Connecticut. So yeah. Second opinion. This is gonna be exciting.
Oh, yes.
I'm very excited for you. What was that like when you got the phone call to get asked to, you know, be back as a host? Which, I mean, it's perfect for you.
It was a perfect fit. That's the first thing. I mean, you know, when I left Good Morning America after 20 years, my attorney said to me, your biggest challenge going forward is going to be knowing what to say no to.
Yeah.
And he was right. And I decided to take his advice and decide how do I want to make my mark on this world? Like, what's my passion? What's at the heart of Joan Lunden? And it was health. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe it's because my dad was a doctor and I always thought I grew up to be a doctor, but that didn't happen. But there's more than one way to help somebody stay healthy. And, you know, when I got, you know, diagnosed with cancer, that to me was like this opportunity got dropped out of the heaven into my lap where I could actually carry on my dad's legacy.
Yeah.
Hard to, like, people say, what? A cancer diagnosis was a opportunity, but it was. But when I got the call, the second opinion has been on for 16 years. This is its 17th year. It's on every PBS station in the nation. It was like an instant yes.
Yeah.
Do I want to do a show about, is it not only about chronic illnesses? We did a show on Parkinson's. We do a show on Alzheimer's. We do a show on caregiving, but we also do issues. We did a show on, we've already shot 10 shows. We did a show on millennial health. Did you know that millennial generation is the unhealthiest generation in history.
And one of the unhappiest generations.
And the unhappiest, most stressed out, most anxiety-filled one. And we also did one on racial disparities in access to health. And they just get the best guess ever because, you know, experts and doctors understand what PBS is about and that it's an educated audience. They know that nothing's going to be sensationalized. Right. And you know what, Amy, we had two, I always had a doctor on set with me, but we had two other doctors who watched the show in real time, always, to make sure that we didn't misspeak ever.
That's fabulous.
I have to say to you that they never made us like redo anything because we misspoke, but that's because we also spent an enormous amount of time ahead of time being briefed and understanding the subject well enough that we wouldn't misspeak. But like my second show was on the coronaviruses. Now, the trick was, how do you interview Anthony Fauci?
Love it.
We shot at the end of September, almost the beginning of October. How do you shoot a one-hour show then that's going to start airing? Because this show premieres in the beginning of January.
Yeah.
So you can't talk about what's going on like today because it'll be outdated. So we talked about all the coronaviruses, and some of this was new to me. I didn't realize that coronaviruses are, it caused SARS, it caused so many different things. It causes the common cold. A coronavirus causes a common cold. Obviously, we've never been able to crack that one because we all keep getting it and there's no vaccine. A coronavirus causes influenza. Now we know about that one. That's very unstable. So we have to get a new vaccine every year. But they've had coronaviruses have been around forever.
Forever.
And they've been studied for decades. So this is just a new, if you wondered why it's called that, new novel coronavirus, because it's now a novel one, a brand new one that just came into the entire spectrum of coronaviruses. One thing that he told me, I don't remember if he told me off camera or on camera, but I can tell you guys, is that it definitely was not created in a lab.
Mm.
They know by the sequencing of the genes that it was created in nature.
Wow.
So that whole conspiracy theory that it's scientifically not able to happen.
Yeah. How interesting. What a fabulous place for you to be. I mean,
it's
you walk the walk and talk the talk because you're challenging yourself now in a new way.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to be, you know, these interviews are, you know, there's a lot of science behind them. You have to prep a lot for these interviews. And so I got to ask you, I mean, do you ever just have fears set in when you're thinking, oh, here I go, I'm going to be on camera again. Everybody's going to be watching me. Do you ever have any trepidation or fear?
Not really.
You
As a matter of fact,
I love that about you.
I think that it's gotten much, much easier over the years since I left Good Morning America. I mean, now I don't have really, but you know what? When you were doing big things, like when we were at an inauguration, out there, you know, in Washington, D.C., and everything was happening and you were doing it all live. Of course, now all news is kind of like that, or at least, you know, the news programs. I mean, there's live spots from everywhere now.
Yeah.
I started in the day where, when I started, I was in Sacramento, California, and I was a reporter and anchor, and we shot our pieces on film. And I had to edit them. And you did it like
really
called a hot splice.
Yeah.
If you took this much and this much film and you put them together and you put some glue and then you hot spliced them. And when you watched it on the air, you just hoped
it goes together.
Hot splice was going to hold together. And then finally we got videotape. And then we got live. And I remember the very first time I was sent out with the live mobile truck and we went out onto Long Island from New York City. We went out to some story. And as we were just kind of pulling up along the side of the road and I was watching them put the satellite, that dish up on the top.
Sure.
And I was then like putting some lipstick on and looking at my notes and they said, Joan, 15 seconds to you. And I was like, what? I just got here. And it was telling to me that the day of being able to go and ask questions and soak it in and go back to the studio and think about it and then have, you know, some time before you had to actually do your story. Those days were over.
Those were over.
You're here, what are you seeing? And, you know, that need to be the first on the scene and have that instant kind of news. The whole news business was changing. And that's maybe the bad part of it. But the good part of it is, like with the advent of everybody having a mobile phone everywhere in the world,
right?
It does kind of give us some insurance that if some dictator or some, you know, cuckoo is doing something horrible to people in some little corner of the earth, they kind of can't get away with it anymore.
Get away.
And that's a good thing.
Yeah.
That's a good thing, you know. Wow. But I'll tell you, I'm glad I did live news.
Yeah.
During the 70s and 80s and 90s. I came into it right at the end of the 70s. I went to Good Morning America about 1977, 78. Wow. I was only 27 years old.
Isn't that amazing?
You know, I think I think back on it now and I think about how young I was.
Right, right.
But I'm glad I did live news then and not now.
Not now. I've enjoyed this so much. I've seen the comments come up from so many people. You're admired by so many. And you truly are just, and I so appreciate the time. You know, I call you a friend and I also call you a mentor because for me, and I talk about the power of mentors in women's life because I think that's so important. You just really
are. I see all these ladies saying hi.
I know.
I did the dedication in my book to all the women that I'm always in touch with on Facebook and everywhere and who I meet as I go around the country and do speeches normally, not now. And I had so much fun writing it because I used a whole lot. Oh, by the way, it's a red cover, which means it's a holiday gift and you're welcome. And I'm working on the next book now, which I can't tell you anything about. But I'm having a hard time, you know, saying, okay, I got a speech that I've got to give next Thursday. Like, go to that because it's so much fun working on this next book.
Yay. Oh, that's exciting. Good. Is it going to be a 2021 release or?
I don't know. I don't
know yet. Yeah. Yeah.
Probably, but I don't know. I'm not that far along in it to be able to have enough to give a projection as to, because, you know, it's a way ahead of time. Projection is when you can get the manuscript done and then you get it edited and then it's a whole big process.
It is. Oh, I'm so proud of you. It's amazing. Thank you so much for taking time.
Look at our backgrounds.
Our periwinkle blue. I know.
Blue and our backgrounds. They're kind of similar there.
Crazy. Well, stay well and
be really careful. Come on, guys. Everybody be really careful this Thanksgiving. It's just not worth it. Zoom them. You can have them zoomed into your table. And
it's just a different Thanksgiving. It's 1 year. You know what we can do?
One Thanksgiving. We'll be okay by next Thanksgiving, I'm sure.
Exactly. Thank you, Joan.
Bye, Amy. Bye, everyone.
We'll see you.